afternoon, South Africa. Welcome to Afternoon Express. Hope you had an amazing weekend. Unjani, Jeannie?
Iphilile, bueno, unjani. No, I've been saying it perfectly the whole day. Now when you ask me on TV, then I mess it up. Iphilile, bueno, unjani. There you go. Got it. How are you? My name's Jeannie D. Welcome to the show. Today we have a motivational Monday lined up for you, starting with one of Durban's favorite radio hosts, Vanessa Morawa. Yeah. She's so beautiful. We're so happy to have her here.
Absolutely. Lots of beautiful women in the loft today. And then we sit down with Sharon Kumalo, who has just been crowned Miss Sundowns, and she shares with us about her experience of being intersex.
She is such an inspiring young woman.
Absolutely.
And of course, that brings us to our social media question today, which is, there's so many perceptions in the world. What perceptions would you like to see changed?
Yeah.
Any perceptions that there are in the world, which ones would you like to see changed?
It could be
changed?
About anything. It could be
exactly.
About work, gender, anything.
Yeah. All you need to do is comment on our Facebook page, Afternoon Express, or tweet us at Afternoon Chat using our official hashtag Afternoon Express. Over to you, Danilo.
We can definitely tell it's a Monday afternoon. Good afternoon, South Africa. And I know this week is going to be a great one. I can feel it in my bones. And so we're starting it off on a really cool note in the kitchen today. Clem, Pedro and myself are making tacos on the show today, but not just any tacos. Mm-hmm. We're going all out. It's a Monday.
It's Pedro's tacos with blackened fish.
Why do you say it like that?
Pedro's
then?
Tacos.
All right, what goes into Pedro's tacos? You've got
we're gonna take some hake, which is quite a neutral flavored fish, and we're gonna blacken it in the best way possible, a whole lot of spices, and we're gonna build our own tacos.
Good stuff. I know there's corn involved, lots of other flavors, so make sure you guys stay tuned to the show right now until the end. And if you want to be ahead of the curve, you can go to our website, afternoonexpress.co.za, find all the details on the recipe that we're making on the show today. Let's start Monday off on the right note. And speaking about starting Monday on our right note, Vanessa Morawa joins us on the couch.
Now, our very first guest, Vanessa Morawa, is a popular radio host in Durban, as well as a TV presenter, but her career started more than 20 years ago when she burst onto the modelling scene in Cape Town as one of the pioneers for females of colour in the mainstream South African modelling industry.
Oh,
welcome.
Loved.
Firstly, you don't
20
age.
Years ago.
You don't age. Tell us your secret.
There's no secret. But okay. You're scaring me. I can't believe it's been that long.
No,
yeah, it has.
I know.
It
we has. Were actually and speaking about it earlier. You've been on TV for
24 years.
Crazy. And yeah. I'm 13, but I told her I couldn't have been on for longer since I'm only 24 years old.
Me too, Jeannie, me too. You've caught me out.
So you started at the age of 4.
Yeah.
Yes, I did.
As a model.
As a baby model, of course, at the age of 4. No, but yeah, I mean, I won't say now, but I was in my teens when I started modelling.
Yeah.
And at that stage, yeah, there really weren't many women of colour doing the thing.
Yeah.
You know, and I also didn't get into it going, I'm going to grow up and be this amazing model.
Yeah.
I was this huge tomboy, my poor mom, who slumped when she walked, was always the tallest in class. And my poor mom dragged me along one holiday and she was like, we're taking you to this deportment just, you know, how to learn to be a lady kind of thing.
Basically like a finishing school.
Like a finishing school. And after all that happened, the agency picked me up as a model and I was, you know, kicking and screaming, of course, because I'd rather be outside playing.
Absolutely. Mm. And you worked all over the country, all over the world. What do you miss it? Do you look back and think about... Maybe did you enjoy it at the time? Do you feel like you should have enjoyed it more?
I feel like I enjoyed it plenty.
Yeah.
Maybe too much, but you know, there's a certain maturity that comes when you're a bit older and you look for different things in life. I think if I had to do it again, I'd enjoy the travel more than I did then, you know, seeing different places, meeting different people.
Yeah.
Back then it was just like a whirlwind. I was young, had no idea what I was doing half the time. And so just went with it. Now at least I know I have my own identity and probably would enjoy it more.
Yeah. And a lot of people think modeling is because it's so glamorous and it's this high life that a lot of the girls don't struggle with confidence issues and that it's something
worst,
they fight.
Don't you think?
It's the biggest battle for models.
Because don't you feel like when you go to an audition or a casting, if you don't get chosen, you take it personally. Like how
do you take it personally?
How do you deal with that rejection?
Yeah, and how did you overcome that?
It takes a long time for you to realize that the rejection is not based on you. I think it's the one job in the world where walking into a room, people reject you immediately. Yeah. It's not based on how much you've studied. It's not based on what you know about the world.
Ability.
It's not anything. It's just what you look like.
Yeah.
And I think that is so hard, especially for younger girls, which I was, to accept that and be like, it's not really about me.
Yeah.
It's about what they are looking for a particular product.
Yeah. And you're also passionate about mentoring young girls. What would you say to young, fresh girls who are just entering the modeling industry?
I'd actually talk to their mothers before I talk to them. I would say to the mothers, make sure that your daughters know who they are, or sons if it is a boy. Because it's easy to get swayed in different directions, whether it's, you know, not knowing yourself in terms of confidence levels, whether it's the drug and alcohol scene that surrounds the industry, as most people know. It's just really about sitting down and parents talk to their kids about their values and what they expect from them.
Yeah.
And did you also have a different set of struggles because you were, you know, a woman of colour? And in that stage, I think when you started out, it wasn't, as you said, there wasn't so many other
girls.
As
inclusive, yeah.
No, it really wasn't. And I think for a lot of the time, because a lot of people didn't really see colour, but when the client is choosing you for something, they obviously do. And it was really difficult to have all my white model friends go off and do these amazing things, and I'm sitting alone at the model house because I wasn't chosen.
Yeah.
So, I mean, these are things that you work through, and you have to understand as well, it's about the product at that time.
Yeah.
And there weren't many products that we're looking for. You know, and back then there was no Kim Kardashian, so if you had a little bit of a booty, you were out.
I actually met you for the first time at an audition.
Did we? Really?
Yeah. And it was for ladies' tampons. And when I didn't get it, I was like, I think that's a good thing.
I think I remember that, actually. And you go home going, phew, goodness.
Do I really want this one?
Well, Vanessa, we've come to know you as a pioneer. And then we saw you a couple of years later on Survivor. And there you were, and you were winning. What was that experience like? Now, I've been on Survivor, and I'll ask you one question. Would you do it again?
I get asked that quite a lot, and I think the answer is yes and no. I've got far less patience now that I'm older for that kind of thing, but I also know more now. So, and it was also a great jaw. It was the hardest thing I'd ever done.
Yeah,
but
me
it
too.
Was a great jaw.
Because how did you do it?
Because
it
was
Bonnie
the toughest thing
I'd
ever done.
How far did you get?
I got to the top three.
Oh.
Yeah.
How? She said to me that for the first four nights she had to sleep on the floor with rats and in the mud.
Mm-hmm.
How did you
and
survive 4 hours, little
crabs
in 4 days?
And all of it,
snakes, everything.
No.
And things that bite you that I couldn't even identify. They weren't mosquitoes, they weren't.
And you hear them walking by your ears and you're like, that thing's going to get me. I know it's coming.
But you're so tired, you actually don't, you almost don't care.
Yeah.
I mean, the moment I got off that island, anything that bit me, I was like, ew, and I was like a complete girl about it. But when you're on the island, you're just like, yeah.
Well, another really positive thing that happens at Survivor is you really don't know what you're made of, and you don't know what's inside of you. Because I went there saying, oh, I'm probably going to get voted out first. And then I ended up leaving the island on the last day of the competition.
No, I mean, I think my family and friends were expecting a call from me, like, within 2 or 3 days, because they were like, ah, she went, now she's back, that's great. And then I was gone for the whole month that we had to be there.
Yeah.
And I did have a moment kind of halfway on the 15th day where I was exhausted. I had I had quite a few meltdowns, actually.
Yeah, me too.
But you somehow, you do realize that there's something a lot deeper in you that you've never even ever tapped into.
Yeah.
Not even tried to tap into.
Mm.
And I wish I could bottle that and, you know, sell that.
Just
I think
take a sip
really
of it every day.
Every morning.
You are totally brave. We're going to find out so much more about you a little bit later on the show. But first, some social media. I've got really short arms.
What perceptions do people hold that you wish would change in the world?
In the world in general? I think for me, any perceptions that are based on generalizations, whether it's race or gender or anything based on, you know, maybe you had an interaction with somebody, color maybe, and that didn't work out so well, and then you kind of have that same generalization of people of that color. It really, for me, generalizations kind of irk me, and I seem to be seeing a lot more of it, weirdly enough, where you think things would have changed in the opposite direction.
Totally. So we asked you on social media, what kind of perceptions would you like to see changed in the world? It could be any perception that has developed around a certain profession, culture, or place of residence. Then we've got some of your responses. Montclair Mpo says the perception that beauty will get you everywhere. That seriously needs to change. I totally agree. Then JD Zama says, my perception is none other social grants that I want to see government earn to unemployment people until you find a job. And Tabi Singh, Angela says, the perception that money can buy you anything.
It can generally buy you anything.
I like to say, people that say that money can't buy happiness don't know where to shop. So let us know what perceptions you would like to change on our Afternoon Express Facebook page, or tweet us at Afternoon Chat using our official hashtag, Afternoon Express.
We kind of had to wait to hear more of your comments coming through on Facebook. We'll read them throughout the show today. What perceptions do you wish would change in the world around you? And can I just say, Vanessa Maroa's voice is literally like honey. More from her after the break.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express live on SABC3. We're still on the couch with the beautiful Vanessa Maroa.
Now, basically, it was the launch of the Tropical Island of Treasure show. And a little bit later on the show, we're going to be meeting a couple of the contestants.
Oh, nice.
And because of that, I thought that I wanted to chat with you a little bit more about Survivor as well.
Okay.
Because, I mean, how did winning change your life? Like, how, didn't you win a lot of money?
Did you win a million?
You do win a million.
What did you do with it?
All I can say is that once you spend, like, the first 200 rand, it's no longer a million, just putting that out there.
Yeah, that's quite
because
depressing.
People are like, you're a millionaire. I'm like, that was maybe 3 months ago, but okay.
Yeah.
What did I do with it? I don't know, not what I should have done with it, let's put it this way.
You didn't invest.
I tried, it didn't work out.
Okay, well, that's okay.
Well, any tips that you have for our contestants?
Yeah.
Have fun.
Did you go in with a strategy?
I did, sort of. I'd watched a lot of the American ones, which I think would be a good place to go.
Yeah.
Ours was the first one. And what I learned is fly under the radar.
Yeah.
Don't be the person that knows everything. Don't be the person that can do everything. Don't be that person.
Yeah, that was my trick as
That's the one that gets booted out first.
Exactly.
If you're a shining star, you get dimmed. Yes, that's what I learned.
Wow.
So I played that. And then when it was time, I thought, to kind of show some skill.
You were like,
I didn't know I'd last that long, but yeah, I was like, I'm still
here.
And then you decided to go into radio. So now you've moved to Durban and you've got a talk show.
I've got a lifestyle show.
But you did a bit of TV before then, and a little bit of acting.
I have
so
done.
You dabbled in a
the
bit
acting
of
thing we don't talk about in public.
We don't talk about
No, you were great.
You went two films.
I know, awkward, but.
What did
I'm not
you
doing
find? What was.
You know, when sometimes you need to know, like, when you must.
What your
just,
thing is.
Yeah.
When you must just leave it.
Just leave it.
No, I think you're an amazing actress.
Thank
Girl, you
too.
Need to high five yourself a lot more.
I should, but yeah. I've always watched it, I'm like, oh, okay.
No. But don't you think it is funny when you hear yourself on radio or you watch yourself on TV? I think everybody
tends to
go. It's
the worst thing. Yeah, you cringe. Yeah, you definitely cringe.
Yeah.
And I mean, doing radio now, sometimes you have to record things that you have to play on air.
Yeah.
And you're like, why do I even have this job? But actually, you know, I love radio. It was one of those things that wasn't in the next steps of what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
And I was approached for a breakfast show a couple of years ago, which we did for a while. And when that got canned, I kind of was like, but I miss radio.
Yeah.
And then I was lucky enough to be given the opportunity again to do, you know, 9 to 12 on my own, which is also very different than being, you know, the whole team of people. And the first couple of days, you're like, am I talking to anyone out there? Because it's kind of weird. You're just there in the mic.
Do you
with the
talk
mic.
The whole time or do
no,
you
no,
play
no.
songs
we
as well?
We play awesome music, yeah.
Okay, amazing.
What do you love most about radio?
The connection. You know, now we have WhatsApp lines set up and people responding immediately. And some days you feel like there's that one person who's sitting at home or wherever and they just needed that from you at that particular moment. And you actually feel that.
That's so
and
that's, special.
You know, those are the 3 hours of my life that actually makes sense. The rest of it, we're just kind of going with it. But yeah, that makes sense.
We spoke about perceptions earlier and stereotypes and people making generalizations. You have a very famous brother, Robert
I do.
Morrow.
Yes.
What does that come with from the public?
You know, what's really great is that we've both had to work really hard for what we do. None of us has gone, okay, you know, my sister can do that or my brother can do that.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, of course, there's going to be that, oh, Marawa, Robert's sister, which, yes, I am. And so that's fine. So I don't think it's been too much of a burden.
Absolutely.
It's part of what it is. I'm hoping somewhere they go, oh, Robert, Vanessa's sister, I mean, brother. I'm hoping
I'm sure
somewhere.
They do.
I'm
but,
sure.
But, yeah, I mean, it's great having somebody in the same industry within the family, they understand
you know,
what it all entails.
Absolutely. Mm.
Let's discuss his girlfriend. No, let's not. But she is amazing.
I'm out.
No, but she's doing very well at the moment.
Absolutely,
she's gorgeous.
Absolutely.
She's amazing.
Mm.
So you've dabbled. You've dabbled in a bit of everything. What's next for you?
That's an interesting question. I think one thing that I really haven't put my full effort into is doing something in terms of a stable something, you know, because everything's been in media and you all know how media is. One day you're up, one day you're down. Some days or some months you're without a job, and that can happen at any time. And I've been through those patches where, you know, it's like dololo. And it's very stressful. So I really want to put something down for legacy as well as for, you know, for my own well-being.
But from a philanthropic point of view as well, you also do amazing work addressing depression and anxiety in certain communities.
No, well, you know, it's one of those things that we don't really talk about too often, too much.
Yeah.
And it has affected me at a certain part of my life. And so right now, having mentored a couple of people that have come through because of the radio show or have seen me on the street and said, look, I'm going through something, and I'm not sure why they feel like they can, but they do come to me. So I wanted to set up a foundation where we do talk about these things and people have a place to go, whereas, you know, there are things in place in society, but I don't think they're that openly spoken about. So it's about having that platform where we can talk about these issues.
And regarding your regarding your experience perhaps with depression or anxiety, how impactful was it that you've come to a point of wanting to help other people?
It really was, Bonnie, the idea that it was not taboo but so misunderstood. You know, if you're going through something and you literally don't feel like functioning, and you can be called all sorts of things. You can be called lazy, you can be called whatever. And the idea that you're not really sure where to go for help is quite frightening.
Yeah.
And it's something that, you know, Chrissy Teigen came out the other day with her postpartum.
Yeah.
And having people that are seen to be having everything come out and talk about it, I think also just...
It's powerful.
Yeah, it's a powerful thing.
Yeah, people don't understand it at all. It's actually quite scary. Okay, we're going to go have
Thank
a look.
Thank you so much for all your social media comments. Yes.
Yeah, there you go.
Let's see what we have here. Lindy Masego says, I love the show. The perception that money brings happiness, she'd like that to change.
Yeah.
Ian Broman says, as a psychology student, I'd love the perception that mental illnesses aren't real to just disappear. Well, case in point.
Thank you.
Ethan Nelson says, hey, presenters, I'd like to see people stop judging others. Hi, Danilo. I don't know if it means Danilo's judging us.
I think he just would say hi, Danilo.
Let's see what he has to say.
Well, hi back to you. I promise there's no judgment in this loft whatsoever. So keep your comments coming through on Afternoon Express's Facebook page. We are Afternoon Express. Would love to hear what perceptions you'd love to see eradicated in the world around you, whether it be at work, in your social life, whether it be something about ability or disability. Share with us Afternoon Express. Coming up after the break, there's a brand new show to hit your screen soon on SABC 3. Those details next.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. And of course, what are we discussing? We
have Tropica Island of Treasure.
I'm so excited for this to start.
Yeah.
I'm actually a little bit jealous that I didn't go on the trip.
I know.
Right?
I've seen all the behind-the-scenes photos of everyone that was having so much fun. All the biggest, like, celebs all together on the islands and looking like they're having an absolute joy.
Oh, it looks like so much fun.
So what is it? 11 consumers teamed up with 11 celebrities.
Yeah.
Basically. Right. Is it 11 or 7? I think it's
7 or 11.
7 or 11. 7-11.
And it's really cool because, and they win a whole bunch of prize money and some of it goes towards charity and there's a lot of money to be won in the process too. And basically, it's like having lots of fun with these different activities that you get to do on an island.
Who were some of the celebrities? Okay, so I know the host is Mini Dlamini.
Yes.
Then the games master is Jonathan Boynton-Lee. Now, just to go to see Jonathan, like,
in
on a beach without a T-shirt, I mean, that's enough reason for me to want to go.
Sylvain Guest is also there.
I mean, everybody who's on there is a looker, really. They're all just...
Well, we're not there, so I don't really, you know...
Everyone. Know. Now, the new season of Tropica Island of Treasure is set to kick off on Monday, the 27th of March at 7:30 p.m. And there was a lot of excitement amongst the contestants at the red carpet launch at New Metro Hyde Park, giving us a taste of what to expect.
I think this is kind of a combination of all the reality shows in one, which makes it quite unique. It's taking all the successful formulas and elements from all the different reality shows and putting it into one big, epic, crazy reality show.
the contestants are really, really competitive and have their game face on when it comes to the competition. R1 million is at stake, so, you know, it's not really fun and games. People are out there, they're out there to win it, and it's a good show.
Tropica put 7 extremely competitive teams on one island. There was nothing fake about the competition.
She's a fighter, so bringing that towards me, I mean, she brought the lion out of me, so I became a fighter as well.
The competition was quite fierce, but it was a lot of fun. I had an amazing partner. He was so lovely and he had the best personality, so we just like, we clicked.
From the first day when I met her, we clicked. We think exactly the same, so I knew it's going to be very pleasant to be on her team.
My experience was very good, man, especially with a person like Michelle. You know, on the first day when we got to throw our first, you know, little competition, we kind of knew, okay, this is what we need to do with each other. And since then, we took off.
We really started to sync really well with each other and really started to begin to understand how each other works and, you know, under pressure or when we need to be pushed a little bit harder or when we need to back off from each other. And that really started to complement each other and we really got to know each other a bit better.
From the beginning, when we arrived at the island, we were like clicking, we're both artists. So when the language you speak is like the same, we understand each other. So the relationship we built is so big that we're like brothers. So after we finished with this Tropic Island of Treasure, we decided that no, let's work on the album.
As two females, obviously they would underestimate us, but little did they know, we show them flames.
And they didn't expect it because according to them, it's a girl team, so they're going to be the weakest links, but they did not see it coming from a mile away. We did show them flames proper.
We are both very competitive people, so it was fierce at all times. We were never there for fun and games. We dominated most of the time, and we had a great time taking some teams down.
She's been very modest, but we're incredible. Absolutely incredible, unbelievably incredible. It was great to be there. We were there to win, 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 win. It was very competitive, the most competitive one they've said they've ever seen, and we're looking forward to showing you South Africa what we're made of.
Our team, I think, was probably the strongest from the beginning. Everyone felt like we are the team to beat, a team to compete with, a team to eliminate. So we were constantly under pressure.
I can safely say that each and every day, whether it was a mental or physical challenge, was equally challenging.
The physical part beat me to the ground. It was crazy. I mean, mentally, physically, it was, I've never heard of anything like it. I've never seen an example of it. You couldn't even get there thinking you know. No, you didn't know.
The challenges were my favorite. I love a challenge and I love to participate in them, so I enjoyed that the most.
As much as they're funny moments, there's a lot of drama as well, you know? You see a lot of emotional sides to people, you see a lot of competitive sides, because that's what comes out of you when you're a competitive person.
Every challenge came with its different crazy moments and funny moments and highs and lows and tears and laughter, and it was just the craziest, craziest journey, the most incredible experience. So I think the viewers gonna have one hell of a ride.
The show though is actually amazing. It's fun packed. Everything that happened there is it's everybody's dream. You wanna be in that space to actually experience. And I think it actually helped me a lot because I grew as a person.
One of the best things about this show is that the contestants and the celebrity contestants are absolutely close-knit. I mean, we became a really, really close family. Evenings were so much fun. I mean, we always had downtime, chilled together, listened to some great music, and then in the morning it was back to competition and back to game day. So it was a lovely, all-rounded experience for everyone.
Wow, that looks sizzling. How are those bikini bodies, though?
No, amazing. I'm just ready to book a trip to Seychelles. I mean, how good did that look?
What an incredible experience. It must have been so much fun.
So we got it. It's 7 teams.
Yeah, basically. 7 teams, yeah. 7 celebs, 7 people who got a really cool chance to go and live on an island and play games for a living. Totally. And to earn so much money in the process.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hello, Vim. Did you get a look on that thing?
The Tropica Island of Treasure theme song performed by celebrity contestants Karlene Unger and Empty is available for download from iTunes and the Google Play Store. The proceeds for this will be donated to CHOC, the Childhood Cancer Foundation South Africa. The CEO of CHOC was at the launch and told us more about this initiative.
Take me to the island, take me to the swaying trees, take me to the place where
I'm gonna find treasure by the sea.
Me and Anga and MD, we recorded a song together. And the song came out really amazing, and I loved working with them. I mean, working with Anga and MD, they're very cool.
It's definitely a song that's meant for a Caribbean island style. So Carleen is an African singer, I do house music, MT does hip hop, but he obviously as a rapper incorporated rap into that, but it's not his style of rap. Carleen didn't do her style of singing, I didn't do my style of singing. So we're in completely different and just catered for the theme of the beat and the theme of the entire tropical island of treasure. Yeah, it sounds absolutely amazing.
It was just like for Tropica and for the show and stuff. And then we all decided that it would rather we'll put it on iTunes and that the profits will go to CHOC, the CHOC Foundation for the kids with cancer.
We've had a long relationship with Clovis since 2004. So one of the things we do is provide accommodation for children with cancer, and the treatment can be for long, or even years. And so we offer them free accommodation around the country in 13 houses. 5 of those houses were sponsored by Clover. So it's a big difference. Childhood cancer is fairly rare, but a growing problem. So we've got about 800-900 diagnosis cases a year, but we suspect half of the cases are undiagnosed. You can imagine a huge traumatic thing for a child to find out they got cancer, for a parent, family members to find out. The good news is that if you get it early, it's pretty curable. A lot of children respond very well to treatment. The problem in South Africa is that we're catching it late, so we need to raise awareness of the early warning signs of childhood cancer. It's kind of interesting because it's a fun, happy, you know, island treasure, and then you bring a serious thing like childhood cancer. But I think it's very important to have that partnership because in all of this, unless we bring those two together, people are just not aware. And plus, the awareness and the support we get is absolutely essential to what we do. We can't exist without the support of organizations like Clover, Tropica behind us.
Wow, and there you have it. Now, don't forget to watch the new season of Tropica Island of Treasure Seychelles at 7:30 on SABC 3 starting Monday, the 27th of March. And you can also win big when you buy a Tropica. Follow the entry details on your Tropica bottle and stand a chance to win daily airtime prizes,
a weekly giveaway of an experience with one of the contestants, sunglass hat vouchers, Daniel Klein watches, or LG home appliances. You could also win the grand prize of a brand new Kia Sportage. T's and C's do apply on tropica.co.za.
Now, after the break, we sit down with Miss Mamelodi Sundowns, Sharon Rose Kumalo.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express live on SABC 3. And our pageant queen, Sharon Rose Kumalo, made her way into the public eye when she became a finalist for Miss South Africa in 2016. And earlier this year, she was crowned with the prestigious title of Miss Mamelodi Sundowns. What makes Sharon truly remarkable is her bravery to speak out about being an intersex female, which is a very misunderstood and stigmatized topic in South Africa. Lovely to have you with
Welcome
us.
Welcome to Afternoon
Thank you
Express.
For having me.
Firstly, congratulations on being named Miss Mamelodi Sundowns.
Thank you.
Actually, in 2016, you were a Miss South Africa finalist
yes.
as well.
I was.
Amazing. When did you decide that you wanted to do beauty contests and beauty pageants?
Growing up, I wanted to be a model for like the longest
really?
Time ever. And I just saw myself like walking the ramps of Milan, Paris, New York.
Yeah.
And my mom's like, girl, you go to school.
Well, look,
first.
With those legs, I mean, you can walk anywhere.
You can walk anything. Yeah.
If I had legs like that, I'd make a table. They're beautiful.
Yeah. So then my mom's just like, no, girl, you go to school first. So I think then just growing up and actually learning what is it that I want to do with my life, and then Miss South Africa and Miss Mamelodi Sundowns was just a platform for me
yeah.
to actually make a difference.
Amazing. So you did go to school and you studied
yes.
biochemistry and majored in genetics.
I studied biotechnology.
And
majored in genetics and biochemistry.
Wow, okay, yes. all of that. Brand of beauty, everything.
That must have been crazy. I mean, that's a lot to take in.
It's a lot on
That's
your
a lot
hands.
Of academics. So you're obviously an academic as well. Do you put a lot
yes.
of time into studying, or you just want to those people that you can listen in class and then you know
and
everything.
Then you can
oh,
ace
not
the
at
test.
All. Not at all. That was like high school. That was high school and varsity. It was like totally different story. And hence, like, I actually failed my first year. And then I dropped out of varsity, and then I went back to school.
Your
and
mom
I
was
to
like,
compete.
You're going back.
You're going back, girl. So for me, that was like, even like my whole varsity career, like I could write a book with that. And it was just like the whole thing of learning perseverance and actually what it is that I want to do with my life, and actually just sort of gave me a proper direction in life. I don't want to just do this.
Now, what is the title of Miss Mamelodi Sundance? What does it entail? What do you have to do?
Well, first of all, I'm the brand ambassador for the football club.
Yeah.
And I get to attend all the games. Yes.
Yeah. Are you a soccer fan? You're a football fan?
You know what? I'm a soccer fan in the stadium. So like at home, soccer is a bit difficult to watch, but in the stadium, oh my goodness, like I don't have any composure. Yeah. So I'm that fan that even if I'm sitting in the suit, like, even like I'm like, so I even lose my composure. So we laugh every time. Like I have no composure at all.
I want to be Miss Man United or Miss Real Madrid.
Wouldn't that be cool?
Now you recently took the courageous step of coming out about your being an intersex female in an international magazine. Yes. When did you first find out, and what did that mean to you?
Well, I was diagnosed when I was 21, and so for the whole time up until I actually started my blog last year, it was a very lonely time, and it was so how I actually came about to finding out was that I had not started on my periods yet. And then the whole time, like growing through puberty, I kept on saying, I'll find out later, I'll go to the doctor later. And then 21, I actually go to my gynecologist, and then he said, well, I can't see your uterus or your ovaries. And I'm like,
whoa.
I'm just thinking, like, there's something so simple. Like, no, we just need to do the surgery, take this medication, gain some weight, then you'll get your period. No. And then after some further tests, then he found out that I have XY6 chromosomes, which are typically found in male. So the condition that I was diagnosed with is androgen insensitivity syndrome.
Wow. So what is in the place of where your uterus would lie?
Nothing.
Nothing.
So I had gonads that were supposed to develop into testes, but then I had them removed. And then, but basically, physically, externally, I'm totally female. And then, but it was just internally with the gonads.
What did that feel like for you, finding this out? Did it change your world?
It did. It honestly did. And I think the one thing that I'm really fortunate to have was my family, because we went throughout the whole process together. And it was just, it was a very trying time. Because, I mean, you keep on thinking, like, oh, no, I'm a girl, I'll be a girl. And then now you think about, like, oh, well, I'll have kids one day. And then now you have to actually say, like, do I really want to have kids? There's so many different ways of having kids. And
can
then
I
you
live
actually,
with it? Is it okay?
Yes, you know, and it was just a very growing spiritual journey as well, going throughout life and actually having to make certain decisions. And actually still at the end of the day, still choosing to live a full life on top of that.
You are so beautiful. And I'm sitting here looking at you thinking, this girl, you're just beaming with positivity. You're radiating.
Just
you're radiant. So lovely.
I was about to say that.
And for me, my heart's broken because I don't know if I would ever have had the strength to, I mean, what was it like? What did you have to face and deal with, and how did you get through it?
I think at the moment, a lot of people ask me, so what does that make you not? Does it make you male or female? Are you attracted to male or female? And for me, because I was raised female, whatever that means, and I've always looked female, and I never had a question about that. So for me, choosing to identify as female was never a question.
Yeah.
So I identify as female, but just as an intersex female, and then I'm attracted to males. But I think for me, it was a very confusing thing. Now you have to think about what actually defines gender.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Because now I think we see things face value a lot of the times that, I mean, you find that a lot of other intersex people where physically you may not exactly be sure whether the person could fall strictly under male or female. And not that they should have to, but then you kind of have to judge, like, okay, the person is, that lady is very masculine, or that guy is very feminine type of thing. It can be very confusing. But I think it's a case of when you introspect a lot and actually choose to determine what makes you you, then it just becomes a little bit easier.
You recently did a blog post about struggles with dating. I mean, I think everybody struggles with dating. I mean, but why specifically in your case?
I think for me, it was a case of when do I tell? You know, because I mean...
That's a whole other issue.
So I think, and the thing is for me, I plan a lot and I'm a perfectionist. So, and then I always had this thing, like, I don't want to lead a person on, and I want the person to know from the get-go. So that should this thing develop into something much bigger, and then we actually go to the altar, that you don't find out, like, you get down on one knee and I'm like, hey, by the way, this is the situation,
but,
and the person changes. So I'd like to a person to go into a relationship with me knowing exactly what it is. And not that I should have to disclose, but then I just want to disclose. So I think for me, that blog post was just mainly about that, like, how do I tell, when do I tell?
So what would the main problem be? That you wouldn't be able to have children, or that you are you still able to be sexually active?
Well, I was sexually active, yes. I would still be able to be sexually active. And then children, medically speaking, not.
Okay.
Right. And how have people responded to your story on your blog?
I think a lot of
openness with it.
A lot of people were very supportive. Like, I think, especially on my blog, it was only like with social media stuff that people were a bit crude and mean.
And silly.
That's just ignorant.
I think the whole term intersex, a lot of people don't understand it. And for me, it's because of something that I've dealt with for the past, I don't know how many years, like five now. That for me, it's something that I constantly hear and I know. And as having studied genetics, it's not strange to me. But to someone else who doesn't know what is intersex, they just hear inter and sex. And they're like, does it make her a boy or a girl?
I don't know,
does she have two genitalia types? Like, you know?
But that's why it's so important that you are Miss Mabalodi Sundowns, and then I wish you actually won Miss South Africa because you've got such an amazing story to tell, and of course breaking down perceptions.
Yes, so it's a big, and I think the thing that I appreciate the most is people actually coming back to me and saying, wow, you actually taught me something. Or sometimes I did a radio interview the one time and a mother called in and she said, I've just given birth to what I believe is an intersex child. And I don't know what to do. And it's like, now what do I raise the child as a boy, as a girl? The medical practitioners don't know. And it's the whole thing of also intersex surgery, which is also a huge thing that people are operating on kids without their consent, and later on it has these ramifications, and it's just these things where I think the biggest thing is parents to just accept their kids as they are, and the kid will make a choice later on should they want to operate or not, and it's totally fine.
And also kudos to Miss Mamelodi Sundowns as a team for supporting you and being with you and giving you this platform as well.
They have been amazing.
Are there, for any viewers that are watching, are there any support groups or any, you know, if people want more help and if they need support?
Well, with there's an organization called Intersect Advocate. It's in the US, and then there's also for AIS specifically, there is a website called AIS.org. And then AISSG.org.
Or of course they can follow your blog. What are your blog details?
My blog is Unraveling. I have it on WordPress, and then my social media, which I also put up links, Twitter and Facebook. No, Twitter and Instagram, it's at IT Sharon Kumalo, and Facebook is Sharon Rose, the Rose of Mamelodi.
And of course, we're going to have that on our website and our Facebook as well. Thank you so much.
Such an honor to meet you.
You are amazing and so beautiful and so wise and astute. Thank you very much for coming on the show. Over to you, Dee.
So what a beautiful story. Cannot wait to hear what you guys think of all of our guests in the loft with us today. So head over to our social media accounts. Go crazy. Use our official hashtag, AfternoonExpress. We cannot wait to hear from you. Do you hear that? Do you hear that?
Yes.
It's the Taco Bell. Tacos coming up after the break. A warm welcome back to this Motivational Monday on Afternoon Express, and I know you've been waiting. What is going to be for dinner this evening? And seeing as on our Facebook page we're asking you the question about what perceptions you'd like to have eradicated, on the show today we're going to be celebrating some of the best parts of our people's culture, and today we're focusing on Mexican. We're making a delicious taco, because obviously we want to show solidarity.
Yeah, absolutely. And the thing is, I think the best way to experience any culture is through the people, the food that they eat. Absolutely.
Great, well let's experience some Mexican today with our tacos. These look so yum. Oh my gosh. What are you gonna be making for us?
Let's start off with the fish, because I mean, that's kind of the base of the stock that we're making. So I've got some hake, and hake's pretty amazing with this dish because of the fact that it's quite neutral in flavor. It doesn't have a very strong fishy flavor. So we're gonna make a rub on it that is intentionally going to blacken as we're cooking.
Yummy,
cool.
All right.
So I'm gonna put you to work, Dan. So what I've got is I've got some cayenne pepper, some smoked paprika, and some sesame seeds, black and white. So if you can do that, so long as I start sprinkling that on the fish.
Oh, sprinkling it on the fish. There we go. It would help if you like, can you just do that? You just mentioned a whole bunch of ingredients.
I'm going to do, not a lot, a little bit goes, what is that?
The cayenne pepper.
Okay, go. That's fine. Go a lot. As much as like you can handle.
Okay, like, and that's how much I can handle.
So a little bit of salt goes
on. You said you want
a cumin? Cumin seeds, and I don't crush them. I keep it whole. I like the way that they pop.
Crunch,
that little bit of a crunch is really amazing. So pepper.
Spanish smoked paprika.
Now a little bit, this is the one, a little bit goes a long way. Dad, I must say,
corner's going to be a
yummy one. The finesse that you use when you sprinkle these spices, it's actually quite amazing. Here we go. So, I'm using sesame seeds, black and white. I just like combining them. Okay, but now you can go a little more on that one.
Okay, you like the sesame.
Yeah. So I love the flavors you get from the toasted sesame seed, and I like the colors between the black and the white. Mm. It's coming together. It's the black. Cool. So then that's on there.
That's a perception I'd like to see change, Clem.
No, but you see, we all come together to make this harmonious, beautiful dish.
And what's this? Is this?
So that's a little ground coriander, a little bit of ground coriander on there.
Okay, coriander seeds are obviously very different to the flowers, and I really am a huge fan of coriander seeds.
But not the flower.
Not the leaves.
Oh, Dan, you know.
Cool, what's next?
Next, so in my pan, I'm gonna go the side that we just seasoned.
Clem, you're breaking your own law.
You know, people get the rule wrong. The rule is actually presentation side down first. Not skin side down.
You've lied to us for the last 2 years in our Food Express.
No, I always
skin
do presentation.
Skin side down was always a thing.
It's always presentation side, so
see,
let's get...
Clem is breaking all kinds of perceptions on this show. When
exactly.
you thought that skin side down was the rule, it's no longer the rule.
All right.
Cool, what's
so,
next?
So, while that's busy cooking, I'm going to start on the corn. So I've roasted some corn, which is just some fresh corn in a pan, a little bit of oil. They go like nice and nutty, like popcorn, actually. Okay. And then
did you just cut that off the cob, by the way? Just
straight off the cob.
Okay, so you steam it in this sort of microwave, whatever it is, and you cut it off? Or
just
cut it fresh?
Straight into the pan, and we just start roasting it off like that, or frying it off like that. So now we're going to make a little side to go with our tacos.
Yummy.
So, guys, can I just say how this was a full piece of Parmesan?
Yeah, let's just say that it took us so long to get towards this point in the kitchen. I was so excited for dinner that I just cut a piece of cheese and...
Oh my goodness, cool.
Parmesan oregano.
Yeah, it is. And it's funny because, in Mexican tradition, Puerto Rican, they actually have a hard cheese. It works so well with this recipe. The closest we're going to get is some Parmesan cheese, and it works
great.
So well. So, spring onion. You're gonna wait, when you hear your corn popping again, then you know it's good to start adding all the other ingredients. So I love spring onion. It's like a great way to get subtle onion flavor in a dish without tearing or
exactly.
like
and
getting
it gives
that
it
harsh
nice
onion flavor.
Too. It's got a very nice sweet flavor to it.
And it also just adds so much complexity and dimension to a dish. Onion's like so underrated.
Mm-hmm. It's also nice in the color. It's much better color than normal onion. I find just the white of onions a bit like meh. So that's
a
bit of green
in there. I know what you mean. But the bright, vibrant green with the yellow and now the red, which we're going to add, it really brings out a lot of the dish.
It's Italian colors almost.
Yeah, the Mexican colors. Minus the yellow, make it white. So just some thinly sliced...
Red peppers?
Yeah.
I'll help you with that word there.
Did it make it seem like... I'm a gag. Sometimes I get a bit like, I'm chopping now, can't talk. Stop, can't talk, can't breathe, I'm chopping. This is what I'm doing.
This is why we make a great team, you know? Don't worry, I'll do the talking. It's my job. I get paid to talk, you get paid to cook.
There
so
we go.
We'll stick to our strengths.
So everything's happening right now. Into the pan. And that's the thing about like Mexican food. I just love the fact that it's so vibrant and so full of color. Mm. It's a great. And actually, South African food as well. We love using so much color and we eat with our eyes first. We really, really do. And we use big, bold flavors. I'm just going to give it a nice shake. Parmesan cheese, where'd you go? Right here. This is where the magic happens.
Oh, it's going to grate that in there. It's almost like a binding agent.
Yeah, it becomes so cheesy and nutty and delicious and corny.
So is this going to be a fritter? Is this the fritter that you make?
No, not at all. This is going to be one of the ingredients that you add inside your taco.
Oh, yummy.
Da-da-da, just mix it all together. And then obviously it melts. It's gonna crisp up slightly. It's gonna be so delicious. Can I get that bowl from you?
Sure, this bowl is here.
You can actually just pop it down. I'm gonna try to aim for the bowl and not get it everywhere. Oh, actually, you know what? How can I forget? We're gonna add a bit of lime.
Oh, zestiness. You've got all the sweetness of the corn. You've got the sweetness of that spring onion. You've got the sort of rich flavors and the creamy flavors of that parmigiano. And now you're adding a bit of zest to it.
Let me grab that spatula from you.
The what spatula?
Spatula. I wonder if we have any Mexican viewers. What do you think?
I think we will definitely. If you are a Mexican viewer of ours, tell us how we're doing over here. And please share some more recipes with us.
Oh,
we'd love to cook more Mexican in the loft. So you can tweet us at Afternoon Chat using that hashtag, Afternoon Express.
Or even if your neighbor's Mexican. Just let us know, because we'll be so knocking on the door, because I love Mexican recipes.
Yeah.
So cool. Here we go. Fish is looking good. We're going to turn over now. You see what I mean?
That looks
it's got
so
a beautiful,
yummy.
Beautiful color on there, quite an intense color. So you've toasted all those spices. You've toasted the fish. Looking good. So that's going to literally take another minute on the other side. But I'm going to show you the platter that I've put together.
Great.
So we've got our beautiful blackened hake.
Yummy.
We've got some easy pickled onions, just in some red wine vinegar. And then with our corn salsa. So cabbage, some lime, some guacamole.
Ta-da, ladies and gentlemen. It doesn't take that long to make. So thank you so much, everybody, for joining us on the show. It's really cool food. You can get the details on our website, afternoonexpress.co.za. Can I take it through?
You can.
La-da-da. Take this through. And dinner served. Ladies, thanks for joining us on the show.
Yay. Thank you so much.
Oh, you ladies were certainly incredibly motivating and inspiring. Thank you very much for coming on the show. And now we feed you.
Have a good night, South Africa. Bye, happy eating.
Bye.
Coming up tomorrow on Afternoon Express, comedian and TV personality Tall Ass Mo joins us in the loft along with his wife, Mome Nale. Plus, we sit down with entertainment journalist and presenter Nikki Greenwald. All of that tomorrow on Afternoon Express, live at 5 on SABC3.